And he saw that in the middle of the flight, she goes on the side and pray Tfilat Shmona Esrei. She daven Amida like this. She has a siddur. He see her on the side, in the middle of her job. He was very surprised. He realized that she's very nice to him the entire flight. But he didn't know. He said, well, some of these Gentiles are extremely nice. Maybe she's nice to me. Maybe she knows I'm a rabbi, so many Christians have respect to Judaism. Maybe that's the reason. Then he asked her, tell me, I saw you praying the Jewish prayer. Are you Jewish? She said, no, I'm in the process of converting. And they started to talk a few minutes, and then she said that she has a Jewish boyfriend, that they want to get married. She's converting right now, but the parents of the boy, of the guy, are against this marriage. They would not let it happen. They fight with him day and night. It will never happen. We are Holocaust survivors, and we will never let our son marry any Gentile. End of story. Find yourself another girl. And it's been going on for months, and they love each other. And she doesn't know what to do. She said, Rabbi, you look like a nice man. She didn't know who he is. That he's also a great musician. She told him, maybe you can do something. Maybe you can speak to them. Maybe, after all, I'm going to be much more Jewish than them. They don't keep any mitzvah. I already keep everything. I keep Shabbos. All I have to do is to go to the mikveh in a few weeks. And I'll be much more Orthodox than them. And they don't want to take me because, you know. So he said, okay, give me your telephone number. Give me their telephone number. And let's see what's going to be. He got the number. He called them up in the evening. He got to his hotel. He calls them up. And he asked to speak to the father. The father came to the phone. They talk about 15 minutes on the phone. He's trying to convince him that it's not the end of the world. She's a nice girl. She's going to be a great Orthodox convert, a real convert. It's nothing to be afraid of. The Torah says 36 times to love the converts, to respect them, to assist them in any way, you know, never to be cruel to them or anything like this. So, I mean, I don't think that this is the right decision. Why she should suffer that there were Nazi Germans who killed Jews? Well, what does it have to do with her now? The father said, Rabbi, I really respect you, but you're wasting your time. There's nothing to talk about. It was nice talking to you. Goodbye. Okay, so he couldn't do it. He called her up. He called this Kathy back. And her father picked up the phone. I speak to Kathy. Here's a... Who is this? Say, Shlomo Karlibach. He say, oh, can I help you? He say, you know, I was on a plane. I spoke to her about the boy, this, that. And I want to give her, you know, the results of my phone call to the parents of the guy. So the father say, Rabbi, I don't care what you did, but I want to tell it to you right now before she comes to the phone that we also not interested. They don't want our daughter. We don't want them. They're not doing us any favor. I don't want. He said, listen, it's a little bit too late. Anyway, it's not going to happen. They didn't agree. And then the guy said to him, I want to tell you something. My daughter doesn't know, but we are Jewish. She doesn't know. We are Holocaust survivors. And we didn't want our daughter to go through what we went to. We don't know what's going to happen in America one day. So let her think she's Christian, end of story. Nobody will ever know. She will never confess that she's Jewish because she doesn't know. So Shlomo Karlibach was a very smart man, and his brain thinks very fast. Right away, he got the point that there's really no problem. She's Jewish and he's Jewish. What's the argument is about? She's not a convert. She's originally a Jew. Right away, he called them up, and he said to the father, listen, you're not going to believe what just happened. I just called the father and I spoke to him, and accidentally I found out they're also Jewish. And he's a Holocaust survivor. He was here, he was in this camp. So when the father heard that, he said, wait a minute, they changed all the rules. You know, the only reason we were against it because we thought that, okay, but if that's the case, then we have no problem. He called them up. He said, would you like to meet each other in my hotel room tonight? So they say, yeah, why not? Let's meet the girl, let's meet her parents, let's make an evening. So as they showed up to the hotel, When one family went in, a few minutes later, the other one showed up. When the man walked in, the father of Kathy, he looked at him. They both looked at each other for about 10, 20 seconds. Fischel! Nachman! I can't believe it! You're alive! I was sure you're dead! They begin to cry. They faint, they put water on their face, they hug, they cry. Say something, Rav Shlomo said. They can't talk. After a few minutes of the excitement, it turns that both of them were chevruta, learning Gemara in yeshiva since they're little kids. And one day the German showed up and took all the guys from the yeshiva. And before it happened, they promised each other that if we make it to the war, we'll do everything we can to find each other and marry our children. And he said, you see, what we didn't do, we swore to each other, Hashem did for us. 7 billion people in the world, the boy and Kathy met by themselves somewhere. What's the chance something like this can happen by itself? And we have people, no God, no supervision, no ashgacha, no miracles, don't believe in it. I have hundreds of stories like this, more or less, of ashgacha. Even with my own people, people I talk to and I see things that happen, it's hard to believe how something like, how Hashem makes such a clear miracle to ordinary people like us in these days. So we have to know one thing. Rabbi Nachman Mibreslev says, Kol ha'olam kulo gesher tzar me'od. I'm sure every one of you heard this song before. Even though it's in Hebrew, every American heard that. Why Rabbi Nachman Mibreslev say the whole world is a narrow bridge, and he didn't say the whole world is a narrow way? Narrow way, narrow road. Why narrow bridge? Why it has to do with bridge now? Everything these rabbis wrote has a lot of secrets in it. It's not based on the mood that they woke up with, right? If his wife made him coffee or not. The mood, you go to the court, sometimes the judge show up with good mood. He made a lot of money, the stock market open up. So instead of going 25 years to prison, today you go only 10 years. His stock went up today. If the stock went down, you're gonna go to 50 years. That's how it works, you're laughing. This is exactly how it works in a secular court. What do you think, someone has fear from God over there? A Jew that eats pork, drive on Shabbat, do all kinds of things, and he's a judge in a court, he has fear from Hashem? If he had fear from Hashem, he'll worry about his own soul. If he doesn't care about his own soul, he care about your soul? If you have to be judged now? It's needless to say, what's the comparison here? He doesn't care about his own. This is, by the way, why in Shulchan Aruch says that a person that doesn't keep Shabbos, now we're not talking about someone who was born in Siberia and he doesn't know anything about Judaism. Well, he's innocent. We're talking a person who knows Shabbat is a holy day and it's the covenant between the Jewish nation and Hashem. And he still violates Shabbat, knowing it's a horrible sin. One of the worst in Judaism. Someone like this, the Shulchan Aruch say, cannot be used as a witness in any case in the Jewish Beit Din. Cannot be. So everybody asks, why? If he saw someone murdering another person, and he said the exact details like another witness, that the other witness is Shomer Shabbos, both of them described the murdered in 1,000 words, almost word by word. Why can't we convict the murderer because one of the witnesses wasn't Shomer Shabbos? What's the connection? The answer is, if somebody doesn't care about his own soul for eternity, you expect him to care about another person? To add a little bit salt and pepper to the story? Somebody like this, we cannot receive any testimony from him for good or for bad. To dismiss the criminal or to convict him, we're not allowed. We're not allowed. Even if he testify what the camera shows us. There was a camera. Obviously, the Torah did not permit using cameras in Jewish court because there's no cameras.
So we see in the camera that Reuven killed Shimon. And now a witness come and also say the same story, but it wasn't Shomer Shabbos.
We cannot use his testimony. We have to let this Reuven go free. Let Hashem take care of him. Why? He doesn't care about his own soul. For sure, he doesn't care about anybody else's soul. That's the rule. That's what the Torah says. It's in seven different places in Shulchan Aruch, in the Jewish Book of Law. Before I finished, in the holiday of Sukkot, just 2 days ago, actually yesterday, also on Shabbat, we have a special reading and a special haftarah. And we read in the Sukkot and on Shabbat the story of Gog Umagog, the final war that will take place in the days of the Messiah, what's going to happen in the world, a massive destruction, so many things. If you read it, well, I don't have time to describe it, it's in Zechariah 14. And what's going to happen? The people will survive, the righteous Jews and the righteous Gentiles that will survive. Then God will come to the Gentiles and say to them, you have to celebrate the holiday of Sukkot. The holiday of Sukkot. But before the big war, the Gentiles will come to the messenger of God and say, it's not fair. God is not objective. He gave the Jews the Torah. He gave them all these holy rabbis to teach them Torah. And he never gave us any serious mitzvah. If you give us a mitzvot, we also keep. What's the question? Just because I was born to Christine, it means I'm a bad person? Of course not. You give me the Torah, you see how I'm going to be righteous. Right now, I'm not a Jew, so I can't keep it. Give it to me, you see. And Hashem said, no problem here. I'm giving you a very easy mitzvah. Mitzvah kala. A light mitzvah. Mitzvah of sukkah. So they go into the sukkah. This is a prophecy. It will happen one day. I don't know exactly how, where in Jerusalem. It will happen one day. And they go in, and Hashem brings the sun out like never before. Very hot day, like the Arizona desert, 120 degrees. You put an egg outside on the street. 2 minutes later you come, it's a sunny side up. You can eat breakfast. You don't need an oven over there. So a very hot day, and in Israel it's also very humid. So the goyim, the Gentiles, they go out of the sukkah, and they kick the sukkah. They kick the sukkah and say, what is this Judaism? It's not for us. And Hashem said to them, you see, I gave you a light mitzvah, even this you can keep. Now, I want to ask you a question. First of all, we have a rule that a Jew that sits in a sukkah and suffers, it's freezing, it's too hot, it's humid, it's bugs, all kinds of things that he cannot enjoy the holiday, is dismissed from the sukkah. Can go back into his air condition or heat and sleep in a normal bed. We are not talking a wise guy that didn't want to sleep in a sukkah, so he built a sukkah next to a construction site. That now is going to be mitztaher. He's upset because he's drilling all day, all night. So he said, Rabbi, I can't sleep in a sukkah. Why? All day there's noise. The Rabbi said, you fool. Why you build your sukkah over there? Because he didn't want to sleep in a sukkah. Oh, next to the public bathroom. Rabbi, there's bad smell. I cannot read Tehillim in a sukkah. I can learn Torah. It's bad smell. Why you made your sukkah over there? Someone like this is not dismissed. He's a sinner. But if he built it in a normal place and a bad smell came later, or the noise that he didn't know came tomorrow, the next day, then he's dismissed. So we know that. So why the goyim are not dismissed? Why they're not dismissed? Hashem brought the sun out. They started to sweat. They came out. And then they said, listen, we cannot take this. And they left the sukkah, and they left. Also, we have to ask a question. Why Hashem called sukkah mitzvah kala, a easy mitzvah? It's $2,000. Go to Home Depot, buy all the things, buy the schach, these nails, workers to help you, drill, tools, $3,000, $4,000, depending on the size of your sukkah. And it's not so simple, no? You want to eat, you have to go back to the sukkah, you want to eat bread, you have to find the sukkah, you want to eat lunch, some restaurants don't have it. It's not such an easy sukkah. What does Hashem mean, the easy sukkah? The answer is, from 613 mitzvot that we have in the Torah, why we have 613 mitzvot? The body of the human being has 248 organs 365 ligaments. For every organ in the body, there's a positive mitzvah. You should do, you should do, you should do. Each order from God connects to one of the organs of the human body. And each restriction in the Torah connects to one ligament. 365 ligament, 365 restriction. When the soul exits the body in the time of death, just by looking at the spiritual image of the soul, right there in the court of heaven, before the trial begins even, they see right away which mitzvah you kept, which mitzvah you were weak, which mitzvah you didn't keep, what restriction you violated before you even open your mouth, before they show the video of your life, before they call all the witnesses against you, all the bad angels who come one after the other to testify about all our sins. Before we get to that step, right away by looking at the image, there are missing organs. For instance, a person who doesn't put tefillin, he doesn't have his left arm. It's missing from his image. A person who doesn't have tefillin every day in his head, he has a hole right here. There's no tefillin, so that organ doesn't exist. And many other examples. The only mitzvah from 613 commandments that a person keeps, that every one of his organs and ligaments in his body participate in it, is the mitzvah of sukkah. Every other mitzvah, it's with part of the body. This is the only mitzvah that as soon as you enter the sukkah, from the minute you made the first step in, your entire body participate in the sukkah. As Hashem says, בסוכות הושבתי את בני ישראל, בסוכות תשבו שבעת ימים, you should sit in the sukkah 7 days, you eat there, you sleep there, everything you want to do, you do in the sukkah. And the schach, the cover that we put, has to be natural. It cannot be something who receive impurity, if it was made as a tool or by a factory to be a rug or for industrial use, it's receiving tuma, impurity, cannot be used. It has to be a natural thing that is growing from the ground. No metal, no aluminum. Has to be a real natural thing, like branches, like the bamboo that we have, we put it on. And this is a memory of the 7 clouds that Hashem sent around the nation of Israel in the exodus of Egypt. One cloud was making the way straight. You know the desert, up and down, valleys, mountains, old people. It's very hard for them in the heat to go in such condition. Hashem made the way straight. The cloud protecting from the sun, and it's also breeze like air condition. Cool breeze. This is, by the way, how the concept of air condition work. With taking advantage on the humidity and the water in the system, and with the freon, the gas, it becomes cold, and that's how it works. And clouds from all direction. And a cloud with a pillar of fire that shows the way. A primitive but very productive GPS. It never sends you to the Arab villages in Israel. Make a left to Baka El Garbia. You want to go to Tel Aviv, you come from Haifa, make a left. What left? If I make a left in 5 minutes, you're going to have to say Kaddish for me. And the GPS insists. You continue to go straight because you know a little bit that Tel Aviv is there, not there. It's a make a U-turn. But the GPS of Hashem, he knew exactly where to take them. One question I have to answer, and we finished. What's the answer? I asked, why Rabbi Nachman say, Kol ha'olam kulo gesher tzar me'od? Why the whole world is a narrow bridge? Why bridge and not a way? Narrow, it can be any way. Why it has to be a bridge? The difference between a narrow bridge to a narrow way is when a person drives on a narrow way and is tired. So one lane. One lane. If you're tired, you get off the way, you park on the sides of the road, and you sleep for an hour. Even a cop comes, excuse me, are you okay there? There's no parking here. I'm very sorry, I'm dizzy. I have to rest an hour. He let you go. Well, what is he going to do? He doesn't want you to make an accident. But on the bridge, you cannot stand 1 minute. If the bridge is one lane, you stop, people will kill you. I gotta go to work. My daughter gets married. Get out. It's not your fault. The car got stuck. If it's in Israel, forget it. You better push the car before, you know, who knows what's going to happen. So the life of a Jew, that's what he wanted to teach us. Have no time to waste. It's very short. It's like the blink of the eye. Every minute is eternity. Every mitzvah is eternal reward. If a person is sleeping and wasting his time on baseball, he won't have enough time in the end to cash on his mitzvot because he wasted his life. Remember, he said, always remember that life is a narrow bridge. If you stand still and do nothing, you sit and do nothing, you watch sport, you watch television, you snore, whatever you do, these moments will never return. There is no permission to stop. You may say, I'm not making any sin, I'm not murdering, I'm not robbing, I'm not going to speak Lashon Hara, I'm not violating Shabbat. What am I doing? Enjoying a movie. Kosher movie, Rabbi. There's no problem, modest. Modest, Rabbi. The Gdol Ador made that movie. It's still waste of time, Bitul Torah. Bitul Torah keneged kulam. Limud Torah keneged kulam. Learning of the Torah, it's equal like all the other mitzvot combined. And canceling it, not doing it, is also equal like all the other sin combined. Why? You have my Torah on your shelf and it's full of dust, 2 inches level of dust. You never open to learn. You're not curious of what me, your Father in heaven, taught you, advised you, recommended you to do. You don't care. So what's the purpose of your life? Just to eat, the monkeys also eat. To sleep, they also sleep. To have a female, they have 5. They don't need to buy her a drink to make an impression. Oh, yeah, so what do you do? He comes, he borrow a car to make a show. Maybe, you know, maybe the date will work out. They don't have the monkey. She move her tail. He bang on his chest. 2 minutes later, they have babies. Finished. Monkey doesn't have to work 30 years to buy a house, to pay the mortgage. No 4 hours in traffic. No problem, no IRS, no FBI investigation, none of the things that we have. So what's the purpose of life? Grab as much as you can. And I like to say this mashal. If somebody puts you in a room with millions of diamonds, blue, pink diamond, rubies, very expensive diamonds, and you say you have 60 seconds, grab as much as you can. And what do? You begin to take, you put in your mouth, you look like Idi Amin Dada now, like this. Then you push into your nose, into your ears, you push into your nose, you put under your yarmulke, you put in your underarms, you put in your pocket, you put in your socks. You know, every diamond is $1,000,000, $2,000,000, $3,000,000, $5,000,000. Grab as much as you can. After grabbing, you fill up your mouth, you fill up every part, and you walk like this, that none of them would fall. You only took 10% of the diamonds. 90% of them stayed in a room, and you came out. Are you happy or are you upset? 10% with you, 90% left behind. You happy or you upset? What do you think?
Upset.
Wow. Hashem, couldn't you make me a bigger mouth? I'll press inside another 100 diamonds. Couldn't you make me bigger and deeper ears? I pushed another 5 rubies in each ear. It eats your heart. This is us. We pay attention to all the things that are really mud. But to the real diamonds and rubies, we walk near them, we don't even pick them up from the street. The diamonds and the rubies of Hashem, like King David wrote in Tehillim, is, what is it? The Torah and the mitzvot and the chesed, kindness, Torah, mitzvot. The more you do, the more you take with you to the life of eternity. And the reward there, Hashem promised, is greater than any imaginable reward you can even think of. There's no words to describe this huge spiritual reward that a Jew will get after he leaves this world if he was righteous and listened to Hashem. There's no end. And days of Messiah, all the tragedies that will happen in the world, the Gemara asks, what a Jew should do to have an insurance policy to get saved? The answer is, Ya'asok ba'Torah u'vigbilut chasadim. Always be busy with Torah, teaching, learning, supporting, whatever, and kindness, helping others. Don't be egoistic. Care about every other Jew. Care about your neighbor. Care about your cousin. Care about your children. Care, your parents, whatever. Help organize. You know, whatever you can do. Charity. The more you do, the more chance you get saved smooth. The world will be a disaster. It won't touch you. You may ask, how can it be? The prophecy in Zechariah is described horrible. How will I get saved for such a horrible days? That's what Hashem said to Abraham. Why did Sarah laugh when I told her she's going to have a baby next year? She was 90 years old and she doesn't have a womb. What do you expect from a woman that she's 90? She walks like this with her cane. And then the doctor comes to her and says, Sarah Le, next year you're going to have a baby. And she knows that they already know she doesn't even have rechem. Doctor, you're dreaming. She laughs. What's the scene? But Hashem says, someone like her, a prophet, Ha'ipale me'Hashem davar? Anything is impossible for Hashem? When Hashem wants to save the Jews, every one of them will have a shell above him. Everything that happens in the world will not even scratch him. But in order for us to be in this position, we have to sweat now. Later, it's too late. If a person, chas v'shalom, passed away, and he has no Torah, no mitzvot, only sins, he lost his chance. Now he has to pay for what he did. But if a person comes with lots of Torah, lots of mitzvot, lots of chesed, he's very happy. Wow, it's great. It paid. I encourage everyone, again, please take CDs. There's the debate with the priest, the Torah and Science DVD. There's an MP3 CD with 15 lectures on it, and also a series of Pirkei Avot. Very interesting. The entire Pirkei Avot in English. It's all free of charge. Thank you very much. Hope to see you again.